according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hands in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord
is risen indeed. Alleluia.
So last week we ended the Gospel of Mark with the empty tomb and the promise that Jesus has gone ahead to Galilee. There is no place we can go that the resurrected Christ is not already there. And today we jump to the Gospel of John. And in the next chapter, we're going to find the disciples in Galilee. But now it's still the day of the resurrection. And the disciples are still in Jerusalem. And Jesus appears to them and gives them the hope and the faith that they will need to go on to Galilee and on to the whole world. It's still only 3 days since the crucifixion. In John, Peter and another disciple have gone into the tomb and found it empty. But it is Mary Magdalene who encounters the risen Jesus and go tells the other disciples about it. So it's later that same evening they are gathered together, and the door of the room is locked. They are afraid. No doubt they're still in shock. The crucifixion is still raw, and they're trying to make sense of the whole idea that Jesus has been seen as risen from the dead. But a locked door cannot keep out God. God comes in the person of Christ Jesus, risen from the dead. Jesus comes and stands among them and offers them, "Peace be with you." They are afraid. He offers them, "Peace be with you," twice. This peace isn't the absence of war, but it's shalom peace. It's a sense of rightness with the world, a sense of well-being. It's a gift from God that is for us also. Jesus shows the disciples his hands and his feet, and on his hands and his side, rather. He breathes on them. The gospel is deeply spiritual, but it's also embodied. The crucified and risen Christ bears the physical marks of having passed through death into new life. His breath passes on the Holy Spirit to guide them in this new life. And then we have that strange saying, if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. Now, Mary Hinkle Shore and Sandra Schneiders make the case that that's a little bit of a mistranslation of John. The Greek also allows, quoting Schneiders, a more adequate reading would be the following: of whomever you forgive the sins are forgiven them. Whomever you hold fast or embrace, they are held fast. In other words, when the sins are forgiven, they are forgiven. When you hold on to someone, they are not abandoned to their sins. In these experiences of Jesus post-resurrection, the disciples are invited to share in forgiving. And when someone among them is struggling to embrace that person, that fits in with John regularly equates sin with unbelief. And then we have, if you forgive someone who has struggled to believe, they are forgiven. And if you hold fast or embrace someone who is still struggling, that person will indeed be held onto, not let go, not lost or abandoned. And that fits in much better with the story we have about Thomas next. Thomas was not there when Jesus appeared the first time. He's not ready to be disappointed again. He needs to have what the other disciples have already experienced before he can give up his loss and his grief over the crucifixion. And that takes another week until the disciples are gathered again. This time they're not as afraid, as the door is not locked, just shut. And Jesus appears again and offers for the third time, peace be with you. He offers Thomas his hands and his side, but the sight of Jesus standing there is enough for Thomas. He has the experience that he needs to believe and to confess, my Lord and my God. This powerful confession, it's actually the only place in the Gospel of John where someone directly confesses that Jesus is God. My Lord and my God. It's on the lips of someone who initially struggled to believe. And it's followed by the blessing of Jesus on those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. That is, all those who would come to believe throughout the ages, including us, who will not have seen the physical body of the risen Christ, but who will experience belief through the Holy Spirit acting in their lives and in the community of the believers. That is the theme we get throughout the readings today. Believing you might have life. A little bit of not peace for the world. But we have the psalm today. It's a song of ascent. One that might be sung as the Jewish people would head up to Jerusalem for the festivals. It's a kind of camp song for along the way. I had one, I was at one congregation where we regularly, the sirens go flying past the window. So. Okay, so our camp song. Actually, it was one, and when I took modern Hebrew a few decades ago, that we actually sang in Hebrew class, the first line of it, how good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. We're reminded that the power of resurrection reaches back as God has always sought life for the people. And in 1 John, we begin with, we declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We're writing these things so that our joy may be complete. And also we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Now, 1 John, it's a letter, it's a great letter about our life and love together. And so we're going to keep coming back to that over the next few weeks. And then we have Acts. At the beginning of the church, the whole group of those who believed were with one heart and soul. And no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. And the apostles testified with great power and great grace, that's mega grace, was upon them all. So this is the only place where we read that the early church gave up private ownership, and it didn't last long. The next paragraph tells of the failure of a couple of the believers. We do get the picture that when the Holy Spirit is moving strongly among the people, sharing is not a burden, but it's a joy. I was listening to NPR's doing a series on siblings. And one of the segments they did is about the joy that's felt by some siblings when caring for each other. One young woman named Caitlin describes her sister as her best friend in the entire world. Her sister is the person she depends on for everything. Now, Caitlin went to college 2 hours away from the family home, and her sister was ill in high school and would call up Caitlin and ask to borrow her clothes or a pair of boots. And Caitlin would drive the 4 hours back home and back to school to bring her sister what she needed. Caitlin remembers one time she only had a 4-hour break, and she drove all the way home and dropped off what her sister needed because she said, in that moment, she really does need it. And then the segment goes on to talk about a study that was done where researchers brought college students into the laboratory from 2 different cultural groups. And they were asked to play a resource game where the students had to decide whether or not to help a family member who needed money. Well, both groups assisted their family members when there was a perceived need. But the participants also had were also having their brain studied with an MRI scanner. And what happened inside the brains of the two groups was really different. In one group, the reward centers of the brain lit up when they were giving their family money. In fact, the reward centers lit up more when they gave money than when they received money themselves. But that didn't happen to the other group. And so the conclusion of the study is that there's a compelling argument that some of us find the act of giving, because we're socialized to be really rewarding. Now, the reward center in our brain helps us feel pleasure and joy. So the difference between the two groups is that in the one culture, the parents often teach their children not so much that they have to help their siblings, but to actually want to help their siblings. And they do that by teaching them that helping brings joy. So why did the early church provide for each other's needs in such an extensive way? They were guided by the Holy Spirit in a situation where, as we read later in Acts, there was real poverty, but also because it gave them joy. So we go back to the gospel. These words are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you might have life in his name. That believing looks like holding fast to God and embracing each other in all our diversity and differences and struggles to believe and to do what is right. It's about putting relationship over being right. It's a tough ask, but not so tough in light of that confession. My Lord and my God. Peace be with you as you walk in this way of risen Christ. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.